Good morning, Axe family, and welcome to our virtual Sunday service. We are so grateful you joined us to lift God's name today, and we thank you for the continued support. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube and follow us on social media at Axe Santa Monica to stay up to date on all things happening. And if you would like to give to our church, you could do so by going online to axesantamonica.org and by clicking on the donating tab. You can also give by mail and send it in a P.O. Box 7217 in Santa Monica, California. We look forward to receiving your gifts. Now this week's verse is Proverbs 16:9, which says, "In their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps." Friends, whatever goals you may have, examine them and see if they align with God's purpose for you. And if we consult with Him before and during our goal planning, we won't only be amazed by the outcome of our goals, but the journey it took to get there. And remember, here at Axe, we are always here for you and we would love to pray for you. So feel free to send in any prayer requests through our social media pages or through our website. Now let's get our hearts ready for Pastor Joe's word with some praise.
How many of you know there's power in the name of Jesus? He's a healer. He will keep you in perfect peace. Whatever you need, just call on Him. Put your trust in Him, and He will supply your every need.
Your name is awesome. Your name is great. Your name is mighty and worthy of praise. Your name is healing. Your name is peace. Your name is all I need.
Your name is awesome. Your name is great.
Your name
Jesus, no other name.
Hey,
yeah, yeah. Bad name.
Well, welcome back, friends. Today I'm going to talk about hope. And the reason I want to talk about hope is because hope is what we need when we establish a plan to get back out into society again. So each of us have ideas about what that's going to look like, what that experience will be like. But I want to tell you something, that you're going to need a little hope, because we hope that we're going to return to normal, or maybe just a new normal. But I want to talk about that. So I began to search the scriptures for something to share with you today in that regard. And I came up with a proverb, believe it or not. And here's what's good about proverbs. You know, proverbs are not intended to be understood as promises or even divine guarantees of any kind. They are general principles. They are descriptions of how things normally work in life. And not only for the believer, but even for the non-believer. And I think it's important to figure out how we're going to normalize things as human beings and coming back together again in society and getting out of our homes and out of our mask wearing situations and trying to figure it all out. And it is difficult. So while each of us may experience exceptions to the general principles that are stated in this Old Testament book of Proverbs, we can still rely on Proverbs for guidance in our daily lives. And one of the things I think that's important is that we have to establish some kind of hope that's temporal, hope that we can use every day to live this new normal with. So I've selected Proverbs 13, verse 12. And here, this is written by Solomon, and the scripture says Solomon is the wisest man that ever lived, and there'll be none ever that will live that's wiser than him. So I think that's important to note, that this wise old sage has said something great to us. Listen to what he says about hope. He says in verse 12, "Hope deferred makes the heart sick." Hope deferred, and we're going to talk a little bit about that, makes the heart sick. And then he says, but a desire fulfilled is the tree of life. A desire fulfilled, a hope that's been realized, is like a tree of life. So now that life is returning to some form of normal, or maybe just a new normal for many of us, how will we plan and how will you move forward in doing life? And I think that this passage is an excellent choice for us to begin to understand what it's really all about. Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a desire fulfilled is a tree of life. So let's look at it in two parts. First of all, hope deferred. What does that really mean? If that makes the heart sick, what's going to make my heart sick? It is good for a person to have hope. But if that hope is not fulfilled for a long period of time, in other words, if it's deferred, then I'm going to be sick over that. I'm going to be anxious over it. I'm going to be angry at some point over the fact that I can't accomplish the things that I hope to accomplish in life. So we need to understand how to live with this kind of situation. We don't want to experience disappointment, especially if we set the goals. We want to set goals that we can accomplish, not goals that are going to disappoint us. When we become disappointed, that's what he means by your heart will be made sick. This is not about eternal hope. See, every believer knows that If you die to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord, that's our hope, right? We hope in what Christ has told us. We're not talking about eternal hope. We're talking about temporal hope. Hope in things that one can set a goal and accomplish the goal. your personal hope and your personal goal. That's what we're talking about. So Dr. Henry Cloud, in his book, The Law of Happiness, says this. He says, setting and reaching goals is good for us. He comments on the Bible. He says, the Bible puts it this way. And now he's going to quote that passage. Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but desire fulfilled is a tree of life. He goes on to say that when we set goals and put legs to our desires and reach them, it definitely does do the heart good. In other words, setting a goal and then turning your heart toward a commitment to accomplish the goal and then accomplishing the goal, that's like a tree of life. That's refreshing for us. It's like being in a desert and all of a sudden you come across an oasis. It's refreshing. And that's exactly what he's talking about. When a runner sets out to run a marathon and she accomplishes the goal and finishes the race, it really does not matter how she placed. What really matters is that she finished. She accomplished the goal. Finishing the 26-mile run makes the heart glad. Yeah, you're exhausted, but man, are you ever excited because you accomplished the goal? Talk to anyone that's run a marathon. They don't talk about their timing and how they finished it within so many minutes or hours, but what they talk about is the fact that they accomplished the goal. That's what makes the heart fulfilled. That's what refreshes us, is accomplishing the goal. That's what makes us happy. Now, Sonia Lubrinsky says, people who strive for something personally significant, whether it's learning a new craft, changing careers, or raising moral children, they're far happier than those who don't have strong dreams or aspirations. Find a happy person, she says, and you will find a project. Further, she says, it turns out that the process of working toward a goal, participating in a valued and challenging activity, is as important to well-being as its attainment. So the fact, what she's really saying to us is that the fact that one sets a goal that they can accomplish in life, and then they accomplish the goal. She says that journey to accomplishment is as exciting as the fulfillment of it, accomplishing it. And the reason it's that exciting is because you know you're working on something that you can't accomplish. And that's what the writer of Proverbs is trying to tell us. Don't set yourself up for failure. Don't set yourself up for unrealized anxiety, but set yourself up for success. So as we go into this new form of life, this new normal that we're entering into, set your goals at a level that you can accomplish them. That's what's important, friends. And that's exactly what the scripture is saying to us. The writer of Proverbs offers a lesson in the discipline of respecting disappointment. That's really what this is all about. Hope deferred, literally hope that is drawn out, makes the heart sick. It introduces depression into the life of a person, and it lowers that person's vitality. We're not as excited about it. We don't wake up every morning with that excitement of accomplishing the goal. Sometimes we wake up in the morning and don't even want to face the goal. That's that depression that comes in, that sadness that comes over us, that doubt that we have that we can make it. That's hope deferred. And that's exactly what the scriptures say. Don't do that to yourself. That's what the writer is saying to us. So this does not suggest that we set goals that are hard to reach. Rather, it suggests that we set goals that are attainable, because as you reach them, your heart is happy. And when your heart is happy, when you're feeling good about yourself, you're going to do a lot better in life. People around you will see that you're doing better. You gain hope and become recharged in the effort to keep on going. So not only should we look at hope that is deferred as something that we don't want to do in establishing our own goals and aims at life, but hope is also refreshing. That's the second point that's to be made about this text. Proverbs 13 and 12 in the B part of the verse says, excuse me, when the desire comes, it is a tree of life. You see, when you accomplish the goal, it's a tree of life. It's refreshing. You're no longer in the desert. You're no longer plodding through life on your own, but you've accomplished something now. So that gives you strength and encouragement to yet set another goal, to yet move forward, to see the importance of life. Let me say it another way. But when hope is fulfilled, a person is refreshed. When you set a goal and you accomplish the goal, friends, you're refreshed. And that's exactly why in the world would Solomon say this? Why would he write this for the people of his day to read? There was a lot going on in his world in his day. But he wanted people to be happy about the accomplishments of life. God wants you to be happy about the accomplishments that you make in life today. And so therefore we take this passage and we bring it into our lives. So the lesson from the poet is set attainable goals for yourself and stop setting goals that involve other people helping you to attain your goals for happiness in life. In other words, how does it work for you to depend upon someone else, to be codependent upon someone else's goals in life? In other words, I set my goal, but they are dependent upon you making your goals. No. No, that's going to be a hope that is deferred because somebody's going to let you down. So what the writer is saying here is that you don't want hope that's deferred. You want that hope realized so that you can feel the essence of the tree of life. You can feel accomplished. Allow me to give you the key to unlock the door of happiness. You decide by your thoughts, by your actions, how you will present yourself in this life. Don't let anybody else decide that for you. You make that decision. Don't turn to someone else for it. Don't depend on someone else's happiness for you to be happy. You bring happiness to the party. And you can do that by not allowing your hope to be deferred. You can do that by establishing goals for yourself that are attainable, that are measurable. Now, I realize that that means that you've got to really think a great deal about what you're hoping for. Yes, you've got to plan. You've got to put something in. You've got to make the effort. That's exactly what he's saying. Hope that is eternal is based upon something that God has already done for you. Jesus died for you on the cross, and Jesus was raised from the grave to justify you. So you have relationship with God because of what Jesus has done. You have eternal hope. You hope to see your loved ones again that have left this earth, even during this COVID time, whether it was a part of COVID or some other cause that took their life. Your hope that is eternal is that you will see them again one day. You will rejoice with them again one day. But the hope that this author is talking about is a temporal hope. It's hope to live out your life on this earth. Hope that is temporal is based on your ability and success to accomplish the goals that you have set for yourself. And that's what we're looking at here. The writer says in Proverbs 13 and 4, the soul of a lazy man desires and has nothing, but the soul of a diligent person shall be made rich. So put some legs on your hope. Don't get engaged in inactive hope, but Engage yourself in an active hope. We never think of hope like that. We never think of hope as encouraging, but hope is all we have. Hope is encouraging. We hope to be at a certain level of wealth one day in our lives. We hope to have that certain position in life one day. We hope to live in a certain neighborhood one day. We hope to have children for those that don't have children. We hope that our children grow up and make something of themselves. We hope that education is available to them as they grow. These are temporal hopes. These things can be accomplished by the efforts that we plan and put in. What God has planned for you, He's already set. If you want to put it this way, it's set in stone. It's not going to change. So we put legs on this active hope. Proverbs 13 and 19, a part of that verse says, "A desire accomplished is sweet to the soul." A goal accomplished is sweet to the soul. Makes you feel good on the inside. You accomplished it. Oh, I'm not talking about bragging about your accomplishments. I'm talking about how you feel on the inside about having accomplished something good. And that's exactly what the writer is talking about. The gratification of hope gives encouragement, like a tree gives life. Tree of life in Proverbs simply means refreshing. You know, it's like in Solomon's day, mostly everything was desert. But then in walking through the desert, just like Jesus did, you come upon a fig tree. And if that fig tree has fruit on it, that is refreshing to you. Or like coming up on a well in the middle of the desert. Someone has dug a well to water their sheep. But here you come upon this well when you are journeying through. That well produces water that gives you refreshing. It's like a tree of life. Well, that's the example. What the writer is saying to us is that you may be living in a desert place today. You may be living in a lonely place today. But what you need to understand is that life is not full of disappointments. If you hope and you plan right, then that hope will be realized and it will not be deferred. And that is what you do not want to do, is defer your hope. There's a practical lesson to be learned from these Proverbs. Proverbs 18. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 18 says this. And it's speaking of wisdom. This particular proverb speaks of wisdom, gives it a pronoun, she. It says, she is a tree of life. So wisdom is a tree of life. To those who take hold of her, and happier all who retain her. So don't just hold on to wisdom, but retain wisdom. Wisdom gives us that practical way to walk in life. Desire fulfilled is a tree of life. What great wisdom that is. I think that's why this is called the wisdom books, right? So accomplishing a worthwhile goal invigorates and it does encourage us. It propels us along the journey of life. It's what allows us not to fall into that state of depression and the doldrums of life, but we lift ourselves up. We pick ourselves up out of the muck and mire, and we keep on going because we've realized some hope, some goal that we've set has been attained. Proverbs 11 and 30 says, "The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life." You know what he's talking about there? Remember that the righteous people, we have an assignment in life, friends. And our assignment in life is to win those that don't know the Lord to the Lord. Listen to what he says in that Proverbs, a complete of that Proverbs. He says that the fruit of righteousness is a tree of life, and he who wins souls is wise. Remember what I told you about wisdom a few moments ago? She is a tree of life. So he that is wise wins souls. So he's telling us automatically that for the righteous, there are goals that are set for us. We have an assignment on this earth. to share our faith with those that don't have it. I have an experience someone shared with me this week, and I'll just share it with you to make my point clear here. They were going into a public facility to get a massage. And so happens that the masseuse was a Christian person and began to share with them their faith. So they connected through faith. And even to the point of the entire massage period, this person was speaking the word into the life of the person they were massaging. The person that received the massage walked out feeling so fulfilled, so encouraged, so refreshed, so new, so ready to take life on. You know what? They were like a tree of life. They were refreshed because hope had been met. The goal, as simple as going in to have a massage, into a place where you know that that's what they do, that's their business, and it's your job to, and it's their job to make you feel better, it was accomplished. So we have a lot to do with how we set up our own lives, our own journey. And I think that's what the writer is saying to us, that we need to set our lives up in ways that we can accomplish things that will give God glory. Proverbs 15 and 4, the A part of that verse says that a wholesome tongue is a tree of life. To say, to speak good things into a person's life, as that masseuse did with this particular client, to speak good things into a person's life, the scripture says it's like a tree of life. It's refreshing for them. So what's the opposite of that? Complaining about life. Complaining does not refresh anyone. So friends, we shouldn't be complaining about life because that's not going to refresh anybody. We should be doing just the opposite, giving them hope because hope is refreshing. Hope that is realized, hope that becomes the tree of life. In Proverbs, it's that which contributes to life more abundant. You might ask, how can I develop goals that are attainable? I know that, you know, you're not hearing a lot of theology here today. I'm trying to do what the writer of Proverbs did in writing it. I'm trying to give you a practical way to see and to think about life. And friends, you have to think in hope, temporal hope. I'm not trying to tell you that you need to get saved and be this super Christian that hopes in eternal life. And so because that's where your hope is, that everything is happy in life, you control what's happy in life to a great deal. Yes, God appoints, but you and I, we disappoint. We even disappoint ourselves because we have the opportunity to plan differently. And I'm suggesting to you that if you're going to be a godly person, if you want to be a fair representative of Christianity, then you need to plan positively and plan in a way that your hope is not deferred and the hope of those that love you and that are around you is also not deferred. Plan so that people can accomplish their temporal hopes. That's being a true Christian. I want to give you some, at least four ways to attain these goals. Let me share them with you. First of all, choose goals that fit your strengths and your gifts. Know your giftedness. You're gifted in some way. Understand that giftedness, whatever it is, and plan accordingly. Plan to utilize that strength of your giftedness. That's one way to accomplish a goal. You know you will get it done. Another is break your goals down into doable chunks. Some of you may have these very large goals. Well, let's walk it back a little bit. You can have the goal, but have some aims, some steps that you aim at taking to attain the goal. When you do that, you are now setting yourself up to accomplish the goals in small chunks. Not large chunks, so that you can be what? You can receive the tree of life. You can be refreshed. And in being refreshed, you can move forward in accomplishing yet another goal. So number two is to break your goals down in doable chunks. Number three is your goals cannot conflict with each other. Don't have goals that conflict. Don't set yourself up for failure by having goals that conflict with each other, saying you want to do this, but you know that you have to do that also. Don't set yourself up for that. That's failure. That's frustration coming. That's hope deferred. That is not hope accomplished. That is not a tree of life. That's not going to be refreshing to you. So again, I'll repeat number three. Your goals cannot conflict with each other. Here's number four for you. Add some structure and support to your goals, and you'll do a lot better. Put some accountability along the way. Share your goals with someone that you love that can help hold you accountable to attain the goals. I want to use a simple goal, simple, as an example. You plan to lose weight, and you plan to lose weight because of your health even. I've had that situation in my life before where I've lost 40 pounds in one venture because I had a heart problem. And so when you have a health problem, your doctors are always telling you to, first thing they tell you is to lose weight, right? Well, set doable goals. And when you set that goal with a person that cares about you and that will help you support the goal, you set a person that can hold you accountable for it, not a person that will beat you up for eating a donut when you shouldn't have eaten it. That's not the point. You want a person that's going to remove the donuts from the presence. You want someone that's not going to say to you, hey, let's go get a small donut today. Let's get a mini instead of a big one. No, you got to have support. Someone that's going to say to you, hey, you know, good job today. My God, I was watching you and you really accomplished whatever that goal was. You really did. You made a good choice. You made a better choice. We need support from one another. Now, why would I bring that up to you? Because there's a passage of scripture written by the same author of Proverbs, the book of Ecclesiastes. Solomon says in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 through 12, listen to these words. He says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie together, he says, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. Now listen to this third line, because I think this final line is important in this text. He says, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. What is he saying? He's saying that have yourself an earthly companion of someone that can hold you accountable for life, someone that can come alongside of you. And even if you fall short of where you wanted to be, they can encourage you. They'll pick you up out of the doldrum of life. They will encourage you to go further. But then he says, don't forget about the Lord. Because if you put God in your mix, a threefold cord is hard to break. Take three cords and just kind of plait them or weave them together. You can't break them. It gives strength to what you're doing. So keep God in your planning is what I'm saying. Don't just depend upon yourself to get the goals accomplished. Set goals that are attainable, but count on God being there to always help you. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. So what's our learning outcome today? We've talked about hope and not deferring our hope. We've talked about being refreshed, as in the tree of life. Well, when we set attainable goals, we reach them and we become people who see life with hope. That's what we learn from this today. We get to look at life as if we have hope. Other people see us and our hearts are happy. They see us as Christians who are attaining steps in life to move through life. Even this new normal that we have, that we're being faced with, we have to decide, how are we going to handle this? Parents have to decide, am I going to send my children back to school full time? Am I going to still school them at home and do part time? Am I going to wait for the summer to be over with and let them go back in the fall? Am I going to give my 12-year-old the vaccination now? Parents are faced with a lot of decisions. Well, friends, develop a plan. Don't allow the hope to be deferred. But accomplish your goals so that you can experience the tree of life, so that you can be, even in the middle of the desert, you can be refreshed on your journey. That's what this message is all about today. The writer of this proverb says that we should never defer our hope because the effects that fall upon our well-being can be destructive. You want your well-being to be good. So friends, today I just want to say to you, hope should never be deferred, but desires accomplished is the tree of life. Friends, I want you to be happy in life. I want you to see this new turn that we've come to in our society today and be refreshed in the midst of your journey, because it is a journey that we all must go through. How we handle it will give God glory, and it will give the church all that it needs to move forward in the society. We'll have more people wanting to be a part of the church of Almighty God because they see the success of the accomplishments of those that are in the church, because they are people of hope. Now, if you'd like to join us in the church, the Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The scripture says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ died on the cross and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Friends, you can come into a right relationship with Almighty God. Now, when you do that, your hope will never be deferred. And I'm not talking about temporal hope now. I'm talking about eternal hope. You will enter into a relationship that has eternal value. You will always be in the presence of the Lord, whether here, alive on this earth, or dead on the other side. God is waiting for us. Would you make that decision today for Jesus? Accept him in your life. Pray this prayer with me, would you? Lord Jesus, I am a lost sinner. I believe that you died for me, and I believe that God has raised you from the dead. Lord, I accept you as my Savior, and I pray, Father, right now, that you would wipe my sins away, that you would take me into fellowship with you, giving me not just a temporal hope, but an eternal hope. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Friends, if you pray that prayer with me, you're already in the ark of safety. God has already welcomed you into his presence. And if you want to walk with him, I want you to reach out to us. Reach out to us through our email or through our website, actsantamonica.org. I want to talk with you. I want to share with you. I want to get a counselor to work with you, to walk alongside of you. I want to make your hope not deferred, but come alive. God bless you.
I would have lost it all, but now I see how you were there for me, and I say I never would have made it, no. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. Now for me, and I can say, I'm wiser, I'm better, much better. When I look back of all you brought me through, I can see that you were the one I held on to. Without you, Lord, hey, I would have lost it all. Oh, but now I see how you were there for me, and I never would have made it without you. I would have lost my mind. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, oh, where would I be? He's been better to me than I've been to myself. Yeah. I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better. Never would have made it. Never could.